Welcome to Nano Matters, the podcast that explores examples of nanotechnology. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Here with me today is Dan Roxbury, assistant professor of chemical engineering at the University of Rhode Island. Dan, can you tell us a little bit about the biosensors that you work on?
Sure. Thank you very much for having me today, Lisa. My work involves carbon nanotubes for a variety of different applications, and one of those applications is in the biosensing area. And actually, the main principle that we're using carbon nanotubes is that they emit light when they are shined upon. And actually, this is known as fluorescence. The fluorescence that they give off is in the near-infrared region. If you're familiar with the visible spectrum from blue to green to red, near-infrared would be just after red. We can't see it, but we have specialized detectors that can see that light. The near-infrared light has many different advantages in terms of biosensing. So we can actually image carbon nanotubes through up to about an inch of biological tissue. And so this is much increased over conventional techniques. And actually, the other advantage, because it's a fluorescence-based technology, we don't have to attach a power source to the nanosensor. We shine light on the nanosensor, and then it gives off light on its own. And so that's basically the principle of the fluorescence. But the other thing in terms of making these biosensors, so we engineer the surface of the carbon nanotube in order to detect a particular biomarker that we're interested in. It can be protein, it can be a chemical, it could actually be, ion or pH. And so there's a variety of different types of biosensors that we can construct that way.
So what are potential applications or diseases or, biological signals you're trying to measure?
So, there's really two main avenues that we're pursuing. The first one would be interacting the nanosensors with individual cells or within an animal. And so we can take these nanosensors, carbon nanotubes, we can functionalize the surface, make them very biocompatible. And we've shown that they actually enter into cells. If that cell has a certain type of disease, we can try to detect that disease with the nanosensor. We've demonstrated that we can do this for lipids in the past. We've made a carbon nanotube-based lipid sensor that goes inside of cells. It detects lipid accumulations. It's relevant for a variety of different types of diseases, mainly cancer, and fatty liver disease is actually another application there. So that would be, I'd call that in vivo sensor. The other main application would be a wearable type device. And so that's our more recent work. We're developing these smart bandages, which actually has the nanosensor encapsulated within fibers of the bandage. And, we've spent time optimizing this process, but we've encapsulated the nanosensor. This can then be placed on a wound of an animal or a person, and then we can get an optical readout from the bandage, indicative of infection or, progress of the wound healing.
So I understand for chronic wounds, having to replace the wound dressing in order to look for infection, in order to inspect it, is one of the challenges that medical professionals have in treating those wounds. Is this an opportunity to reduce the amount of unnecessary dressing changes?
That is exactly what we're going after. Especially think of large area wounds, chronic wounds that cover a large surface area on the patient. Unwrapping that wound and cleaning that wound and rewrapping it, it's a very time-intensive process, and it can actually introduce infection to the wound. And so, we're developing these large area bandages that would give us an optical readout of basically how the wound is doing. Is the wound progressing and it's healing? Is it being invaded by a pathogen, which would give us an infection? And really, that's kind of what we're going after there.
Can you share some of the challenges you've encountered and how you overcame those challenges?
Obviously, we've been developing this technology for many years now, and it starts at a very fundamental level, understanding how different biomarkers molecules like proteins, lipids are interacting with the nanosensor. But really, in the last couple of years, actually, we've been optimizing the smart bandage that we have created. And, you know, in that process, we have to optimize many different parameters. We have to choose polymers that are FDA approved, that we can interact with the nanosensor that wouldn't give us any type of bad response or quenching of the fluorescence. We have to optimize the process conditions. In general, we're very methodical, but there is a little bit of trial and error there. And, you know, that's kind of basically what fundamental research is, though. So,
what are your plans for translating this from the bench to the bedside?
I'm glad you asked that. You know, we're looking into that now. So I'm at the University of Rhode Island. We don't have a medical school, but we do have Brown University, which is not too far away. You know, and I have made contacts there. We are going to be starting some in vivo studies, hopefully in some type of mouse or rat model. If that looks promising, we move to larger animals, perhaps a canine model. And then, you know, we try to translate into humans after that.
Can you share your vision for how you see this technology having an impact in the future? So you mentioned the wound application and also detection of lipids, which can be indicative of some cancers. Where do you see the biggest impact of this technology, and where else might you be able to use it?
What we're trying to go after now in terms of, you know, some type of wearable device that can be non-invasive, basically anyone can wear this. And really, we want to make some personalized device that a patient can wear, doesn't even have to be a patient. We're thinking outside of wounds entirely. We're looking at like sweat sensors or any type of wearable sensor that can give us a readout of the health status of a person. And in parallel, we're developing technology similar, let's say, to like an Apple Watch that would give us that optical measurement of our sensors, and then it would wirelessly maybe directly contact a physician, you know, and it would alert your physician that you have some biomarker that could be relevant for a particular disease without you even knowing it. And that's kind of, you know, this automatic fashion, that's what we see as the future.
Well, that sounds very exciting. And I really appreciate your time and sharing your research and your thoughts for the future with us. Do you have any closing thoughts that you'd like to share with our listeners?
So basically, nano is anything but small, you know, and I've been in this field for over a decade now, and I just try to read as much as I can, and there's just so many fascinating aspects of it, so many new applications, new technologies. The field is just continues to grow exponentially. I still think it's important to fund this type of, you know, fundamental work because, you know, 20 years down the line, that's when we see this technology come out to the general public.